Okay, we'll call this meeting to order. First thing we have is the approval agenda with an addition.
Move to approve with the addition.
Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Any citizens to be heard? See any? Okay. Approval of the minutes from June 21st and 28th.
So move to approve.
Second.
Any discussion on that? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Passed. Payment of bills.
Move to approve.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? That passed. And with that, we'll go into the budget introduction. Brian Burke and Lori Johnson, Auditor Treasurer. Our favorite time of the year.
I can tell.
Love the paperwork.
Ah, yeah, 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 yeah.
We're gonna have a lot of mics to work.
Make sure you have one. Have a microphone.
Well, good morning, Mr. Chair and members of the commission. We are starting this, I guess I'll say, long path down the road to a maximum levy at the end of September, and then to continue reviewing the budget and presenting it to the public sometime the first part of December, and letting you make your adjustments or establish the budget, I should say, first, and then you make your judgments, adjustments if you need to after the public hearing, and then go for a final vote towards the end of December. Now, you have quite a bit of information in front of you. You only had one page sent out in your packet. We do normally give you the printout of 100 and some pages of the actual budgets of the department. Frankly, we do not have that totally ready to go yet. We're close. We could have presented one to you, but we were going through it last week and we noticed some significant changes that needed to be made. So, and the other thing that was ringing in my ears is that you folks did not want to start up in the double digits this time around to work your way down. So we're striving for accuracy before we get there. Although the summary does show us right around the 12% levy right now with growth of about 1.78, and I did hand that information out to you, so it's still in double figures, and I was hoping that we would, the first summary that we present to you will be down in the single digits, and we're hoping to get there. I don't know how we're gonna do it, but well, in the memo that I did present to you, we normally list out the new requests. There's only a couple new requests this year as your direction of trying to keep this a more conservative budget. And this is, what I've been saying is an employee budget this year. There's a sizable cost of living increase that has been negotiated with the unions, and we know that our hospitalization costs are going to be quite high, but you do have two new requests that we'll be presenting to you. Is that the squeaky wheel? We do have two new requests that'll be coming before you. The county attorney has informed me that he is requesting two new full-time attorney positions. And the corrections is asking for money for a transitional team to start in 2017 for the new jail, and the sheriff's office is here today. I guess you can start certainly considering that and listening to the justification and trying to determine as we go down this road. I know it seems like we're starting early on the budget, but 2 months seem to fly by so quickly. The next items on there in the regular budget, I've listed some of them. The cost of living adjustment that has been negotiated with the unions. That's not for all yet, so that's for your determined to make. The insurance costs, we feel pretty confident that it's going to be within this range because that's a 2.5-year average. That's a 30-month average, and then last year was 12.5%. And I'm assuming this year is going to be in that area and sounding like the medical conditions that we've had under our accounts and things that we're probably going to be in that range. The county program aid, we have not received that figure yet, but that's last year's figure that you see there. And there was some talk, and I don't know where that exactly lies yet, but that the legislature added some dollars to the county program aid, and that would be distributed to the formula, but they're also writing a new formula for it. So I think we're close close to the $3 million county program aid. MCIT dividend, that figure came out in the bulletin of what their gross dividends were going to be. So I did some calculation and using the percentage that we received last year and different things. So that number may change just a little bit. Since 2014, you've been adding the $50,000 to the jail construction, the general levy for the jail construction. Out-of-home placements are going to be very high. Rhonda will report on that, but I think you're well aware that the price is running really high on that. She's looking at her averages, so she's trying to bring in a 3-year average versus bringing just one spiked year, and I think we have to be careful of that with any of the budgets. We have a new facility that needs to be paid for by highway. I think Dave is thinking there should be some money left in this year's to help make that payment, but then after we met with him yesterday afternoon, we received an email from him about the, I think it was the traffic lights. I'm not sure. He'll describe it when he gets there better because it was just an email and I read it real quick last night. No, it was the $500,000 right to the city of Moorhead for that street over by the new school. And how do we want to budget for that? He has not put that in his budget, so we'll be talking to you about that as well. Also down there, the rebate dollars for the housing starts. Lori estimated around $400,000. Last year was $389,000. You did not put that in the revenue side. You used reserves for that because you felt there would be a roll around. So is that in the budget?
Yeah, that's
that is in the budget this year.
Is that the difference between what, or don't we have any coming off yet?
There'll be one group coming off.
Okay, yeah. So is this the difference?
No, I'm not calculating a difference in there. Okay. Because that's just part of the taxable base.
Yeah. But what we pay out for that incentive in 2017, it's gonna exclude the first year.
Yeah, and actually it'll be 2 years coming off.
Okay, so should it be 400,000 anymore?
Yeah, because we've got new ones coming on, because we renewed the program.
Okay.
So it's like we've got 2 years going off, but every year a new year comes on because it's still going on.
Okay. But the average increase will be reduced. Because we went, the first year we did this.
Well, it was low and then it went high and it'll stay high until we end the program.
Right.
But we'll have that increased tax base to spread the levy on. So.
But it shouldn't go higher.
It shouldn't.
It should remain now. Okay.
That's what we hope.
Well, I mean, if it goes,
it's a good thing.
Hope for growth.
If it, yeah, if that's it goes, exactly what I was going to say. Higher, that just means your tax future
great.
Tax base is
spikes, but you hope for growth, right?
Yeah, your future tax base is going to be better if it grows. But.
And then the last item is, I'm assuming you want to handle it like you've done other years, and you certainly will, unless you want to do it some other way, is that we're having the departments, we've scheduled four of them today, I believe, are scheduled in, three internal and one external department to come in and present to you their budgets. So you can have a better feeling of theirs, and we'll continue to schedule departments in, if that's how you'd like to handle it. Any questions or concerns or direction on where you want to go with it, how you want to handle it, what do you want it to come in at?
Well, a double digit is too high.
Well, we know that.
Mm-hmm. You know, I think we do need to hear from department heads what they believe is necessary to operate. Then I also think we need to hear what would happen if some of those requests, you know, what are the ramifications of not doing it? Or is there other areas that could, in each department, that could be reviewed and changed to help compensate for some of the increases? You know, I'm thinking about all these people out here who are going to be paying these bills, and there's school referendums, and there's all these other things that everybody's paying for too. And we want to stay competitive here in Clay County. We don't want to be going through the roof with our levy. So we got to find some happy medium here.
Yeah.
And I understand that there are new requests that are important. What I appreciate is when these departments look within to see what may not need to be in a budget anymore. It's easier to justify new requests if we can find some sort of item within that can be cut out.
And I think you'll see as you go through this, this increase, I don't want to say is in the criminal justice system, but it has to do with the expanded activity that's going on in this area. Our jail population is up. Out-of-home placements are through the ceiling. Our juvenile detention is experiencing costs. I think I didn't mention that. Steve is going to be asking for the county to go from 7 to 9 beds in its purchase program with the county as well, which is an expansion of costs, but that's where he's at right now and has been for some time. So that I had forgot to ask that. I guess that is a new request. It's an increase in the activity, such as the out of county boarding that we're doing with the jail. So it's really not a new request. It's an extension of, but those are some of the big. It's all revolving around the county attorney's office. Their work is just expanding. So a lot of the increases that you see in the budget are revolving around this. I won't say the criminal justice issue, because there's, I don't know if social services would consider themselves a criminal justice issue, but they have lots of issues that we found out in that committee. So with that.
Yeah. I don't know if you're going to go through this per capita too, but that really shows. As far as Clay County, it shows that we're doing real good compared to these, compared to Norman. I mean, you gave us comparison, Norman, Wilkin, Otterdale. You know, we're sitting very good here in Clay County. I mean, yes, we're spending money, but we've got a lot of people to service here. And but if you look at that per capita rank, you know, I mean, we're sitting at 82 out of 80 in taxes. We're sitting 82 out of 87. You know, it shows that we're really down there. We're doing real good. However, yes, we do need more money.
Yeah.
So it's.
Well, Mr. Chair, thank you for bringing that up. I handed out so much documents for you to review today, but I meant to go through this cover sheet. And the one that has the first sheet on it is a estimated market value on the growth. And we hand that out every year. That's 1.78% on the growth. The next sheet on it is your history of your levy increases over the last umpteen many years, 20 years. I think that's kind of important. And then you have two sheets. One is the statement of the revenues and expenditures, basically your fund balances as of the, I think it was March 21st. And those numbers will show you the fund balance in each of those accounts. And then the second page is a fund balance comparison. The ending year that on the revenue and expenses is just about identical to the last item that is entered on the other fund balances. The second sheet, though, compares year to year, so you know where your fund balances have gone. And I know you've relied on fund balance a little bit the last couple of years, and you'll see that we're still in pretty good shape, but we've gone down some in some of those fund balances a little bit. And then it gets to that comparison. And yes, I printed out all of the counties surrounding us for comparison's sake, if you want to spend a little time looking at that, because we do get compared to our neighbors. And per capita, we're the lowest spending county per capita to us and our neighbors. So that's a very good observation.
It's a very good place to be.
Yeah, yeah.
Not that it's going to cost us any less.
But well, that's what it's going to
cost. I mean, we are doing good as a county. I think we are operating very good.
Yeah, the others are the goals and objectives in the external agencies, and they handed out the sheets that you're going to be reviewing today with the departments. So, Lori, you have something?
Yeah.
Very good.
Thank you.
And with that, we'll go into the Sheriff's Office budget presentation. Steve doesn't get to come up here at all.
I won't be here yet.
Okay.
That'll be over shortly.
Oh, yeah. Are you coming later?
Well, I think we can start with the board's, but probably supplied with this narrative copy that we.
Yes, we have.
Narrative. So we met with the county administrator yesterday, not once, but twice. We got beat up fairly well, and
you look okay yet.
Well, I saw us yesterday after we were limping and
bandaged.
Yes. So you know, there's a lot to talk about. There's a lot of things going on in the sheriff's office world with the new building, the new jail, and the possibility of the law enforcement center, the armor system. So I think we'll just dive into it. We'll discuss the law enforcement piece. To begin with, please stop me if you have any questions, but really in the overall view of the law enforcement piece, we're flat. We're not asking for any new requests. There are some changes that we had in both revenue and expenditures. Mainly that was just an even change. We saw a little more funding, and we're hoping to see a little more funding in some of the state programs and a little bit of decrease in others. There's a significant one with impound fees that you're going to see there. Really, that's just a wash. For many years, our business practice was to use a checkbook. Last year, we went away from that, so it was our first year in 16 trying to decipher how we were going to account for this through Lori's department. It's worked very well. Lori's staff has been great to work with. Really, that is any vehicle we impound. It's money coming in, money coming out, so it's an even wash. The only expense that we really have to that lot is we pay for snow removal, which is about $3,000 to $5,000 a year. So when we impound vehicles, the subjects are paying for the fees of the vehicle for the toll, for the most part, unless they're seized. So that's a significant increase, $20,000, or decrease in revenue, but it's made up on the expenditure end. Does anybody have any questions with that? Okay. Pistol permits. Every year we see more and more pistol permits increase. I think we're going to see that again with the recent activities in the country. However, you know, that revenue is limited in what we can spend on. It can only be spent on programs that support that pistol program. so we can't use it for general revenue. But we try to use that as much as we can. We've bought furniture with it, computers, monitors, stuff that the county would normally come out of the budget. We have funded that through pistol permit monies. There's quite a bit of money in there, so unfortunately we have a difficult time spending that down, but we try to be as creative as we can to avoid using general.
When you look at that $19,000 increase there, what does permit cost? What is, if I want to get a permit for?
It's $100 for a permit to carry.
So you're looking at that many more permits being issued this year?
Yes. Any national tragic event sees a dramatic increase in pistol permits.
So those permits have to be renewed each year?
Every 5 years.
Okay, very good. Thank you. Did you have a...
That was my question.
So unless anybody else wants to really talk, the changes are minor. One of the big changes I'd like to talk about a little bit of time is the armor system. For many years, we have contributed money to our internal service program, which is a great program for us and every department, I'm sure. So we're looking at about $800,000 program coming into 2017. Almost all of that will be covered under internal service. The good thing for 2018, maybe not so much for 17, is that we currently spend about $20,000 a year in tower rent, electricity, propane, that kind of thing for our towers that we don't have to spend now after the armor system, because we're renting towers from the state at just a fraction of that cost. The other thing is every year we're putting money into internal service for a tower at the landfill, shelters, generators. We will no longer have to have that kind of funds in that for that infrastructure. We'll have to have internal service money for user equipment like squad radios and portables, but not the shelters and towers. And in addition, we hope to sell those, at least those shelters and that generator, hopefully to somebody close. That's revenue that's going to come in, because we no longer need those tower sites and those shelters. And those shelters are $30,000 a piece or so. We have a generator at the landfill that was $30,000, $35,000, $40,000. So unfortunately, we can't really reduce too much of those accounts in 17, because we are counting on state grant money for some of these armor system pieces, and we have been disappointed with some of those grants that for dispatch, for example. We're hoping to get 7 councils paid for, they only paid for 3. So we have to be a little careful of what we're hoping to get, but definitely in 18 you're gonna see you should see a dramatic decrease in some of those internal service accounts and radio equipment maintenance account.
Now you said some of this stuff's going to start in late 2016. So did we put money in the budget last year for 2016?
It's all through internal service. That armor program is completely funded by internal service and state grants.
And there's enough there?
There's enough there.
Okay.
And finally, with the law enforcement piece, with speaking to or with the county administrator yesterday, our fuel has been high. You know, that was budgeted for about the $4 a gallon. We haven't seen that in a couple of years. So we did, which is not described in the packet you have, but we did decrease that $30,000 for next year, in the hopes that there's no hurricane or anything to send that fuel prices skyrocketing again. So, coroner, you know, our community is growing. We're getting more populated, and with that, our coroner expenses increase. We've seen an increase, slow increase in autopsies every year. So, we had to throw in a few more autopsies to cover that budget. Still, there's other coroner services available out there. This is still by far the cheapest coroner service in Ramsey County to you or us. So even the one that's in Grand Forks.
Even with the transportation, it's...
Even with transportation, yes. I think we'll save corrections for the last, because that will obviously, we'll spend the most time on that. We'll move to dispatch. Large increase in dispatch fees again this year. Again, it's all directly related to our population growing. They had a 1.5% COLA for their employees. What they do is they take an average of the five agencies, and that's what their cost of living is, and that's applied the year after. So maintenance on that new world increases every year, just like any software maintenance does. And there was a large piece of software that was purchased by through the consortium through New World that will greatly help us out in the civil process. Two of the agencies, Cass and Clay County, serve civil process, and it was a piece of civil process software. So any questions on the dispatch budget?
So what are we looking at the total increase to be for dispatch over 16?
I have to go back to this. So last year it was 373,000. Mm-hmm. This year it's 408,000.
35,000.
And I should point out as well, we're in the second of 3-year phase in with that new memorandum of understanding with the city, so they're paying based off of their population now, not some archaic formula.
So did theirs go down and the county went up?
No, theirs is going up again.
Theirs is going up.
Actually, the cities, those four cities, theirs is going to go up significantly this year. Let's see if I can highlight that.
So will that offset a portion of this 35,000?
Yes. Yes, it is. They're paying more of that dispatch budget than in previous years. And then next year, in 18, that will be the end. So they will be paying their population, their 100% of their population for that.
That's something we changed last year, I think.
That was, yes. So just as an example, I can tell you that last year those cities paid $68,000 for dispatch combined, and this year they're paying $136,900. So, however, going back, yeah, that was a flat fee for many years.
Then, right.
And
right.
So with no inflation, so there was a lot of catching up to do there as well.
So going back to my question, so our costs are up for dispatch by $35,000, but we're going to be receiving more revenue.
Correct.
Because so the net impact to Clay County
will be less than.
Will it wipe out that $35,000?
No, it won't, but it'll be less.
Okay.
Any more questions with dispatch?
Not for now.
And then I can let Brian speak to emergency management. This is fairly easy as well.
Everything is pretty much the same as last year. I did have a little decrease in the grant by $2,000 from the state of Minnesota, and it sounds like it's going to stay the same this year. We had one disaster. Basically, it's just try to keep everything informed, and all the expenses that I have are pretty much the same as the year before. Really no difference in my budget in the last 2 years. Again, I just want to, the way weather is going, we have to be kind of careful that it might change. And of course, we all know about it from there on. So,
are you required, Brian, to update this emergency plan periodically? And does that add costs when you have to do that?
No, it does not. That's built in. Okay. It's a 4-year cycle that I have to go through for the emergency operation plan. This year I have my plan, I changed it to, it's called the ESF, Emergency support function, which is, it kind of just rewords things to make it more simpler. And then I have, this year I have a peer review. There will be three other counties that will be in attendance, and I go over certain aspects of my emergency operation plan to review it along with the state personnel. Next year, I believe that the board gets to review it again, so you get a nice hard copy and you can look at it detailed.
Okay, and then finally, I just want to mention before we move to corrections, definitely the hot topic, I think, today in law enforcement is body cameras. We delayed our purchase of cameras like that for until the legislature decided what to do with the data. So they have made somewhat some decisions on that. However, I think what we're going to do now is wait until we decide what is going to happen with this law enforcement center. Any system, and I'm sure every department has it, when you buy some kind of a computer system, you have software, you have this maintenance. Well, we already have squad videos, which is about $12,000 a year maintenance. And we're going to have interview room cameras and body cameras. So it really would benefit the county budget if we had one system and we paid one maintenance instead of three different maintenance contracts on this. So I just want to let the board know, although we think that's important, the squad videos were a great asset to our department. I think the body cameras will be as well, but we want to wait a little bit to figure out where this jail or this law enforcement center is going to go. In addition, whenever you, if you've seen one of our patrol guys, if you've seen them in uniform, they already have a mic for this for the squad video. We don't want them to have that mic, the radio mic, another body camera mic. So we're working through that to decide what would be the best system. But if you do get questions from the citizens we are looking at, then we think it's important. But it's an incredible expense when you talk about the system, the server, the storage of all that data, and maintenance as well. So we hope to take care of that in the upcoming years with our normal budget. But I can see that this is becoming so popular that country that some of that systems will increase in price too. So we hope that we don't have to come to the board for additional funding.
Hey, Matt, have you been checking with the IT department in terms of the design of the new LEC? Will that handle all of these future communication or with the technology? Will it all, are you talking to them to make sure that you're going to have up-to-date stuff there, where if you bring in these body cameras, that's all going to
We haven't gotten to that yet, but we have spoke to both of those departments, just really where the two IT server rooms are, one for Morehead, one for us, that we share those fire suppression systems that are so expensive. So we might as well have them together, separated by like a chain link fence, and have one system. So Morehead, the city of Morehead PD, they're suffering through the same, or I should say suffering, but they're trying to research the same issue. They have squad video cameras, they know body cameras are the future. How do you integrate that into one system when you have three separate systems and it's all expensive? And where do we store all that data? As we know, the legislature wasn't really, didn't solve that to the way we wanted it to. A lot of that data is public, so we have to keep that data. Well, video data is very large, and it costs a lot of money to store.
Files are big.
So I just wanted to, in case the board is getting any questions on that, that's kind of our plan. So I think I will pass the torch to Jules.
Okay. Well, we'll start with revenues. We do expect some revenue increases for our work release program. We've been seeing more inmates on our work release program. We're projecting an additional $15,000 in revenue.
Do we have anything set up when you say revenue projection on that we don't charge anybody anything, do we? Or
yes.
We just, or you do charge in some cases?
Yeah, anybody who goes on work lease gets charged $20 a day. It's a privilege to get to go out to work, so we can charge it for that. It's a common practice.
But as far as the people you do the work for, there's...
No, this is work lease. These are people who go to their normal jobs.
Oh, excuse me.
Yeah, the other ones are work detail and SDS. They're either working off time or fines.
I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
Okay. We'll move on down to our expenditures. We did make a change in our salaries overtime budget. We dropped it down to $20,000 based on the past couple of years. Then we'll just keep going on down and hit the highlights of the big increases. The first one would be professional services. There's a federal mandate called PREA out there. It's for every jail and prison in the United States. And it requires that all of them be PREA compliant, which is the Prison Rape Elimination Act. And it requires a lot of different policies and procedures within a jail, but it also requires an audit, and we have not yet had our audit, and we would like to get that done in 2017. It's something we should have in place by the end of 2016, but if we have a schedule in 2016 for 2017, we'll be fine.
How often do they require that audit?
Every 3 years. My next one is prisoner board. And that has to do with meal cost. Just a little brief history. Our current vendor has come back to us within recent months and said that they can't afford to continue our food service at our current price, and we've had to renegotiate a new cost increase, which we'll bring to the board within the next couple weeks. In addition, they've implied that next year it could be higher or they will not be interested in our contract. So I've reached out to the community to see who would be interested in our food contract, and the prices I've been getting back were from Concordia, and it could be anywhere from $3 to $3.25 per meal, or up to $10 a meal a day per inmate. So based on those figures, that's why we have to see such an increase in our food budget for 2017.
I have a question in regards to that contract. Was there any sort of clause in that if they weren't able to fulfill the contract? Was there a bump for us on that?
Jenny, would you like to touch on that?
Yeah, they had an option to terminate the contract, or we could renegotiate for a new price. And so we felt it was prudent to renegotiate for a new price to the end of this year. And then I believe Julie's plan is to put out RFPs for a new vendor starting the first of the next year. So we either had zero food contract, or we could renegotiate, and I think we did a pretty good job. The rate increase, I mean, it did jump, you know, 60 cents, but from what they were asking for initially, I think we did a pretty good job negotiating.
Thank you. Our next increase would be prisoner care. The increase is based solely on the fact that we have more inmates in our custody. Even though we ship our inmates out of county, we still are responsible for the medical costs that is not included in the boarding fee. So that increase is just going to cover our population. Prisoner board. First 4 months of this year, we've seen an increase of almost 12 inmates out of county, more than we had last year. And based on that, at our going rate, we feel that we're going to average close to 53 inmates out of county by the end of the year. And if you times that by $52 a day, 365 days a year, you're going to come up with this over $1 million we're going to be spending on boarding costs for inmates to be housed in other counties. No, it does not. I take that back. So one of our contracts does include transports, okay, but that's in the $53 or $52 a day.
Is that the one that goes there?
Tri-County. Yeah.
I knew the answer to that question.
Yeah, just wanted to point out. That doesn't also include the staff costs we have running the program because there's so many inmates coming in and out of our jail. Lastly would be our jail supplies. It's a minor increase, but due to the fact we have more inmates and the cost of things, we have increased our supplies by $1,900. Does anybody have any questions on the main jail budget, or should we just dive into my new requests? Let's talk about our new request. Okay. Well, we've been talking about billing this jail for many years, and I've talked to a lot of people through the years, and they all tell me You make sure you have a jail transition team. And the people I've talked to have been the National Institute of Corrections, Department of Corrections, and other jails in Minnesota. And everybody said you need to have a transition team so that this facility, when you build it, is ready to go and your staff are trained and comfortable in there because you're building something that they've never worked in before. We're going from a linear jail to a direct supervision situation, and our staff have not been trained nor have had any experience in that kind of situation. So what I've done is I contacted some of the Minnesota jails out there that I've built in the last couple of years. And the ones I've contacted, you know, they range in size of beds. The smallest one was 84 beds up to Crow Wing County, which was 286 beds. All of them had transition teams. They all started at groundbreaking. The smallest jail of 84, they had two for jail transition at groundbreaking, one of which was a jail consultant that they hired from with outside. Everybody else, Tri-County, which was 200 beds at the time, had 2.5 when they started. Immediately, shortly thereafter, they had to hire another one, and they went to 3.5. Blue Earth County had 158 beds. They had 4. Douglas County built 156 beds. They started with 2, quickly added a third. Crow Wing County had 286 beds, and they had 5. I have proposed for a 204-bed facility, which actually can go to 4. And I based that on, after talking to National Institute of Corrections and laying what we're building, and also the Department of Corrections. So that's how I came up with the 4. And the 4 were to start at the beginning of groundbreaking. And just to go over some of the things that transition does, because I mean, some of you may have even heard of the term before, but just to give you an idea, the purpose of transition is to reduce liability by researching and having policy written and trained on before you move into that facility. They will be involved in the policy and procedure for all aspects of the jail, as well as workflow, scheduling, programming, classification, and regular jail duties. When we move into this new facility, everything we've been doing is going to be completely different. They will have to set up post orders for every position in that jail, because when you have a jail built like this, you are required by DOC to have post orders at every post in that jail. Currently, we have 2 posts in our current facility because of the size and the way it's built. In this new one, every cell block will be considered a post, including booking and roving. Some of the other things that we'll do, they will be creating scenarios as this thing is being built. And the scenarios are for anything from removing people in a fire evacuation to normal daily activities to a worst case scenarios. Not only are they going to walk them through, develop those scenarios, they're going to write them down, and then they're going to have to train every staff on that so that we know when we walk in there, we know exactly what to do in a situation. We don't have to fumble through it when it happens. We don't have to look at each other like, what are we supposed to do? This is all going to be written out ahead of time, planned on, and trained. Some of the other things we're going to be doing, the whole process of moving inmates over to the new facility could be very time consuming. You have to have an overall strategy. You can't just pick them up, grab their stuff, and throw them into a new facility. You got to make sure what their classification is. You got to make sure they don't have separations. You got to make sure what you can do with their property, assign them, and make sure everything comes over it. So it's going to be, it's a slow process. You're not going to be able to just take everybody, throw them into the new jail, and then walk away. It's going to take us time to transition into that new facility. Some of the other things we're going to have to change, probably our jail schedule. Somebody's going to take that task on and figure out how we're going to operate that jail with the staff we're going to be given. It's not going to be the same schedule we have over there and just add a couple extra people. It's going to be completely different. There may be power shifts involved. There's going to be probably more team leaders involved. There's going to be more programming staff. The other thing we're going to have to change is our classification system. Right now, we have a pretty simple classification system. But when we move into this new facility, we're going to have a general population pod. We're going to have a mental health pod, which we've never had before. We're going to have a whole separate area for work release, and a female block that's going to have all its classification within that cell block, but there is separation by the way we built it, but you're still going to have to organize every section of that jail. Along with this, with our new world software that we all have here in Clay County as well as Cass County, we will have to create a whole new jail into that system, which means every bed has to be created, every property storage location, every questionnaire we ever have put in that system has to be rewritten, and the whole system basically has to be written just for their Clay County jail. Lastly, one of the most important things is actually transitioning to the jail and training our staff. These people on the transition team will be our go-to experts for that jail. We're going to need them for months after we move in there. They're going to know how those doors work. They're going to know those security electronics. They're going to be helping when those things are being put in place, what they're operating. They're going to know the backbones of that system better than anyone, and we're going to need them there while it's being built so they know what's going on later on when we're actually in the facility. They will train every staff member to make sure that they're comfortable when they move in there. I've heard stories that a lot of jails, when they move to a linear to a direct supervision situation, they lose a lot of staff because the staff are nervous and scared when they're just not comfortable going into a situation where it's 1 and 60 inmates. We don't want that to happen in Clay County. We have great employees. We want to make sure they're properly prepared and properly trained so that when it's time to move to that facility, they're comfortable and they stay here with us. Because like I said, we have great employees and we really don't want to lose anybody. This is a great opportunity for all of them to be able to work in a new facility. And so that being said, that's what jail transition is. And like I said, I recommended 4 people for this position. After speaking with the county administrator and getting bruised and beaten a little bit, we've come up with an alternate plan. This alternate plan does have some liability to it, so I'll be upfront with that. But what we are proposing at this point is to start two in February 2017, and then one more in November of 2017. And by doing this, we can reduce my request down to $132,154 instead of the $255,000. The liability issues are if this jail isn't ready, where we don't have the policy and we don't have everything set and our staff aren't trained properly and we're not ready to go, a 30 days delay moving at the facility will cost us $78,000. So there's a cost there. And also, if we wait too long to have our transition team come in there, they're going to be working in that jail. They're going to watch it while it's being built. They'll see something that maybe a construction manager won't see, or something the architect didn't think of. They build jails, but they don't work in them. And these staff can see something and maybe say, we need to do a change order now because this is going to cost us a lot more later on, because this isn't going to work with the workflow. And for operating a jail, this is a bad idea. We need to change the door swing. We need to change the way this door is located. And that could save us a lot of money if we have them on board at groundbreaking. So with that being said, that would be my new request. When you build a jail, you should have a jail transition team. I think it's part of the construction of a jail.
Okay. What is the length of time the counties that you would talk to typically have their transition team on the ground before? Sure.
They all have them at groundbreaking. That was one of the specific questions
I asked.
But
the time before? Like how? Is it a year process, a six-month process?
It's usually about an 18-month process. As soon as the shovels are in the ground, they have their team in place.
So what is the lowest amount that you talk to with these other counties?
The lowest was Houston, and they had 2, one of which was the jail consultant. And that was 84 beds.
And they had the 2 18 months of training?
18 months at groundbreaking.
Okay.
However long it took them to build their jail.
Would you be looking at our people being the transition team?
I would pick from the existing jail staff. Yes, I wouldn't recommend a jail consultant. I think our people are skilled, knowledgeable, and they can write the policy for this facility, and they know how we operate here in Clay County. So I would be very comfortable picking our team from our current staff.
Jenny?
My other question is, it seems that we have a unique situation here to which your jail staff has been very involved in the planning process and on the jail committee. My question and concern with the cost, clearly, of a jail transition team is that I feel that you've had ample opportunity to be in on the process and watch the design period. Is it necessary to have someone during the build process watch that when they really were in on the planning process and we've all seen the schematic mm-hmm. designs?
Mm-hmm. Well, they'll be doing more than just that. I mean, that's just a very small portion.
Right, I
get
that.
So they'll start the policy right off the bat. And then when they're doing policies and trying to run through scenarios, they're going to be looking at those plans while they're being built.
But you also said one of the benefits is to have them watch the day-to-day build as well.
Right, as they're building policies. Yep.
Julie, the last time we talked about this transition team was in our jail construction committee, where we learned about this, and I'm glad you're bringing it forward early on and talking about it with the full board here. And I know you had mentioned that you would like to lead that transition team yourself.
I would have loved that, but I think at this point I'll be more of a supervisor, but I'll be doing my regular duties. I don't think since they wanted me to cut this,
okay.
I was the one they cut.
Okay.
I cut myself.
Okay. So in doing that, with the change in your duties, would you still would you still be the eyes and ears of the jail admin group to be kind of working together with the contractors?
Yes.
So you're still going to be there?
I'll be in contact for all that.
And you're going to be looking at their weekly things they're doing and?
Yes, I'll do that. I won't be able to do more of the policy stuff. The team will have to create that, go out there, research it themselves, and then myself and Justin will have to approve any policy and procedure.
Yeah, because that's where most of that really is. We talked a little bit before the meeting about, you know, we're not going to have to reinvent the wheel here. But in some instances, we do have to reinvent the wheel.
We do.
Because like when we're going from a linear style to a.
I mean, a simple thing is laundry, it's a big deal, laundry, well.
Right.
That's a whole process that could is.
And you've got, and now you're going to have a kitchen, you didn't have a kitchen before, so you got.
Thank you.
There's the whole processes there. My issue there, and I'm glad that you were able to work with our administrator on this. I still think my issue on this is that this shouldn't be part of the 2017 budget. I think this $132,000 needs to be part of the jail construction project cost. Because this is, you know, because what you're doing is you're creating what is going to be a long-term permanent process which goes with the building.
Correct.
It isn't a one-year type of an expense. If this is a one-year type of expense, it should go in a one-year budget. But this is almost like a capital investment into a policy that and so I think we need to say fine with what you're doing here in a jail transition, take it out of this budget entirely and put those dollars into the cost of the jail and it'll be paid for through that process. That's just my feeling on it.
I agree with that.
I think it's a more appropriate way to go about it.
I agree. You don't build a car and then have somebody else pay for the owner's manual of it.
That's right. That's exactly right.
Yes.
It becomes part of the cost of it.
I agree.
So, you know, so Brian, as you're going through with this budget, that would certainly be my request that we try to figure out how to take it out of there. Now, granted, by putting that $132,000 into your jail, now we don't have a unlimited jail budget either. So we have to find ways to make it work within that. So. But I do want to comment, too, that we did have the Department of Corrections. They did attend the jail construction meeting when we talked about this issue, and they were very, very supportive and highly recommend that we do move along with the transition team. And I think it would be a significant error on our part if we didn't do it at all. So
thank you.
Mr. Chair,
I didn't get that exact figure you were asked to cut out.
132.
132 for transition.
Well, I hadn't originally asked.
What was the original cost?
255.
255. Almost 256,000.
Okay, 255. If the board decides that this should go into the not the yearly budget, but into the jail cost. Would the county administrator and have any objection to going back to what you originally asked for, or is that us becoming micromanagers?
Well, he's asking if it's going to go into the jail.
Yeah, in fact,
do we go back to the 255?
Yeah, well, that was one of our discussions yesterday. In fact, I think Chief Deputy Zero. His comment was if there was some savings in other areas, would this be more acceptable to go to that? So we talked about that. And I think Commissioner Campbell has the right approach to this. This is a construction cost because we don't know the savings yet. We have to put together a plan sometime along the way of what is the savings out of county boarding and what are the increased costs and things like that. So I think at this stage, taking it out of new requests and making part of the jail plan is much more palatable to everybody.
If I may, Mr. Chair, we're talking over a $50 million project, so going back up to the 255 is infinitesimal, I think. And,
we'll see what everything comes out at, I think.
Well, that's it. I think that, you know, if the 132 will work, you can always build on that if you need, if once you're starting and showing that you need additional help, you can add on, but the fact is, if we start at 255, we're never gonna decrease this score.
Right. And we can always do updates to the board on where we're at for transition.
You know, I think my suggestion is we take this out of the new request, out of our 2017 correctional budget, put it into the jail construction budget at the 132, but at the same time, we have to realize in our jail budget, we're going to have a line item there that is...
You're gonna have increases.
Well, but you're gonna have, you know, we have, right now we have a line item for unknowns. Or contingency.
Contingency.
You know, so we have dollars in a contingency. And if, as this thing moves along, progresses along, if we're able to save on the contingency, which we're trying really hard to plan that, then, you know, maybe say mid-2017 or the fall of 17, you're still gonna be 9 months away from your opening of this new facility. Right, because we're talking about an 18-month construction
right,
period.
But you wouldn't want to wait that long to start.
Well, no, but you have the 132 to start.
Right, okay.
That's what I'm talking about.
Okay.
Yep. But then 9 months down the road, or 9 months before opening, you know, we could then take a look. What do we have left in our contingencies? Is 132,000 working? Mm-hmm. And if it's not working, then tell us.
Sure.
And then we can. But we'll operate through the jail construction budget, okay. Not your correction budget, because it's unfair to have it in your construction in your corrections budget.
Good.
Mr. Chair, does that need action, Brian?
I don't feel it does.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you for the highlight there, Matt. Julie.
Yeah, good work, guys. Thank you.
Hello, John.
What do we do for a break?
Not till after Dave.
Well, Dave's not here yet.
I know.
We can probably quickly go to the reports. You want to? Since you're leaving, we'll let you do yours first.
I can find it. Yep. On Tuesday, July 5th, Ward Planning Commission. General business, we granted variances to Doug Restemeyer for DNS Beverages at 201 17th Street North and for A. Noah at 6204 Broadway Street Northwest. And we passed on to the City Council unanimously for final approval a house moving permit for A. Noah at 6204 Broadway Street Northwest. Final plat request for Churches United for the Homeless in Bright Sky Edition, and for J.V. Haug, preliminary plat approval for the Prairie Meadows 6th Edition and the rezoning of all lots within that same edition. And those last three items go on to the City Council for final approval, and that's my report.
That Prairie Meadow, where's that located? Is that just by the railroad, or?
I think it's, I am not sure, but I believe it's far south, south and east of Reinertsen. I believe.
Okay.
I think so.
Kevin?
I had no committee reports for last week, but I did attend the... we did. That was after last meeting, wasn't it? Yeah. I better look back then. Yes, we did have a highway tracking meeting. That was to re-review the
methane gas,
and we've determined that this proposal to heat our facility just is not feasible, cost-effective to do. So we're going to be back to the drawing board to look at other ways that we can at some point in time deal with our methane gas. That would give us some sort of a financial advantage and not just burn it up. Then I did attend the noon yesterday deal with the Corps of Engineers and the that milestone breakthrough of the signing of the PPA, and I was Glad to be there and glad to see that done.
Jenny?
I didn't have any committee reports last week to report on, but Thursday is Government Day at the Clay County Fair, and they are advertising that various departments and representatives from the county would be there. So I do encourage us to be there from 3 to 7 to enjoy the fair.
Grant?
I was at the signing of the project partnership agreement yesterday, too. It was a nice event, and I think historic for the region, and the diversion project here was one of only six in the Corps of Engineers that is actually being funded this year, so it's a pretty big deal, so.
Yeah.
That means money will be available and that the Corps of Engineers will be spending money on the project.
Yeah, yeah, I attended that too yesterday, and I tell you, I was really impressed with the leadership that we have in the community. I mean, all being there in that one room there, it was an impressive signing of the diversion of the partnership agreement. Highway tracking, yes, last week we met at highway tracking. I do agree the report we got didn't give us the right information, I don't think, to make a good decision that methane gas should be used for that building out of the landfill. And until we get some more, better, or complete information, I think we should go on with our present plans that we plan on doing. And also last night I went up to Morgan Township. They had their picnic there, and Sheriff Burkus was there along with one of his deputies, along with Shanna from Solid Waste. There's also speaking there. It's a good township meeting. It's a Morgan Township's people are very involved in that township, and it was a good meeting to go to. And that's all I had. Dave, you want to come up?
Morning. I've got two items and one item addition, if it's all right, that I had. I got late in the week, I got a limited use trail permit from MnDOT. It's for that project down in Barnesville that we're sponsoring. I'm supposed to see if I could get approval on that document as well. My first item is a little 2017 budget presentation for the Highway Department. And I met with our highway accountant a couple weeks ago, in which we normally do, and Ann and I go through things, and most of the budget is basically kind of a trend. We take a look at where expenditures are, and the dollars aren't real high, so we kind of keep things as flat as we can. And then we go through some of the bigger items, and then what we have for upcoming big projects and capital improvements and things like that. And then yesterday I met with Lori and Brian, as well as highway staff and highway accountant, and we kind of fine-tune things a little bit and summarize things here for you. Some of the general tendencies that we're seeing from the highway department or road and bridge is, and I think you can notice this too, construction bids have been coming in pretty good. There's still a fair amount of competition out there in our area, which has been nice. We've been seeing really good bids, allowing us to have a little more bang for our buck. So we're trying to get as much done as we can. The board, I think, was very supportive on maybe trying to advance some construction, which is what we're looking at doing in about 3 weeks with an overlay on County Road 2. So we'll find out if hopefully they're still competitive there. Another thing we've noticed, and as well as everyone else, fuel has still remained pretty low. So that's a huge part of our budget. So that's been very helpful the last couple of years. Equipment has continued to rise about 3% annually, but at least that's something we can keep our hand on a little bit. No big surprises there. One thing is, I think we're finally done with the large increases due to emissions on some of the equipment. So they stage that over four different tiers. They call them tier one through tier four, which is nice. I think we're finally done with the emission spikes. One thing we noticed about a year ago, the state aid allotment did go up quite a bit. So our construction revenues are up a little bit, which helped out quite a bit to the tune of about a couple $100,000. So that was kind of nice. And the last thing is we're still seeing some staff turnover due to retirement. So, I mean, it's sad that we're losing the staff and the experience, but yet it does help the budget, the final dollar. So I guess kind of good and kind of bad. Some of the notable changes that we made over the last couple of days with our road and bridge budget, something we discussed at Highway Committee, we did discuss moving the new county construction funding from $350,000 to $400,000. That was a change that I actually had kind of talked about making a year ago, but I missed putting that in there, so I guess we'd like to put that in there for 2017. I realize that's a $50,000 jump to our budget, so as a result, we took a look at a couple other items to try to offset that a little bit. We are going to be a little bit lower on our needs for consulting, so we did lower that by $10,000. The small tool item hasn't been utilized to its full amount the last few years, so we lowered that from $18,000 down to $13,000. So that was a $5,000 reduction. The fuel, we're just speculating, and it kind of was a little hard to do it, but we did lower our fuel budget by $20,000 with the hope that the fuel stays down. In the road materials budget, again, we've been doing a lot of our cheaper fixes with our spray patching and crack filling and some other things. Our crews are getting pulled on doing other smaller projects, so we're not spending quite the dollars that we had in the past when we've been doing a lot of asphalt paving. So we lowered that by $15,000, which then kind of offset that $50,000 increase for the new county construction funding. So, and then the last thing that we did do is we, a year ago, we increased our shop replacement kind of shop line item by $50,000. We went from 70 up to 120. And what we did now is we actually kind of earmarked that in the internal service fund. So we worked with Lori a little bit. So right now we put, I think we put $600,000 for 2016 into the internal service fund for equipment. And we're still short on that, so she does jump that up by about $50,000 a year. So for 2017, she's going to increase that to $650,000 for equipment, and then we're going to take that $50,000 that we had in there and slide that into the internal service fund just for shops. So it's not an increase to my budget, but yet it's, I think it's going to be really handy to have a little earmark in there for our shop replacements, because in the near future, we're going to have to look at our Ulan shop. It'd be a single motor grader shop. It'd be quite a bit cheaper than the Barnesville or the landfill one that we're looking at, but it's nice to have some money for them.
It's actually worth $750 for equipment. It's
okay. I guess that's kind of the main points with the road and bridge. Brian, did I miss anything?
No, you covered it quite well, and the sheet that you will receive next week, that cover sheet with the percentage on it, does show that highway, I think, is still, except you did send us an email last night, and I mentioned that to the board already during my report on that construction, that you were looking at $100,000 a year for the next 5 years to pay that city thing. So that would increase your budget quite a bit if you go that. So you may want to address that.
Sure. We've been working with the city of Moorhead on 12th Avenue project. They're going to be building a new elementary school, and we've had negotiations, and the city's currently got about 70% completion on the plans. It's about a half mile of road. It's a county road. The city built the first stretch from 34th Street out to Horizon, and they're looking at building another half mile. There's going to be a lot of new development there that I think from the county standpoint we feel is going to be good. It's going to generate a lot of tax dollars, going to be a lot of homes, and possibly some other construction of some kind in that whole area there east of Horizon School. We've been kind of talking with the city and have verbally kind of agreed to a $500,000 cost share on the roadway. It's going to be much more than that, but we took a look at what we've been paying for about a half mile of roadway, and we felt that was pretty equivalent if we built it to our standards. That's what it would be. They're going to probably have a third lane. It'll be a three-lane section. There'll be curb and gutter. There'll be sidewalk and things along there. So,
are we going to turn that back to?
And I think they've been pretty favorable in agreeing to some sort of a turn back too. So it'll be about a mile of turn back, back to the city. So, in most cases, entities completely reconstruct a road and then turn it back. So this will be a cost share turn back. I think it's good for the county and good for the city, but we need to come up with that $500,000 somewhere. It's not a state aid project right now, so that we wouldn't really be able to use our state aid dollars for it. But so I think right now we do have intergovernmental payments to the city for, I think it was 40th Avenue South quite a few years ago, about 10, 12 years ago or so. I think the easiest way would be just to try to utilize that same mechanism for paying them back with some sort of a schedule, but still the dollars need to be in there. So that's kind of what Brian was referencing. We thought maybe if, and they were agreeable to possibly looking at a term of up to 5 years or so, they would assess it and then we would just pay them back. So it'd be 5 years plus some sort of an interest, probably calculation in there too.
You mentioned the Yulin shop, you know, is that, I know you, evidently you're looking at a new shop or something like that. Is Yulin the right place to put it? They're not even in that, we're not even, they don't contract with us.
Yeah, you're right. It would not have to go back in the city of Yulin. We talked a little bit about maybe combining Yulin and Felton, but there's just so much dead space up there that it might be a little hard to figure out how to do that. Right now, the winter snowplow truck does not get housed there. There's not enough room. It currently gets housed in the city of Holly, but the plan is to move that truck to the landfill with the new, we have space for it there in the design. So I'm not exactly sure where the best location would be for that, but you're right. Maybe there's some sort of a combination between Yulin and Felton somewhere that we could find some land and that would make sense for the district, so.
Do you have a value on that roll log shop, what you're expecting that?
I think the assessment, if I remember right, was about, it's kind of a rough assessment we got, but it was about $50,000, I think.
And you're hoping to roll that into your highway payment or the new?
That was our plan, yeah. We'd sell both those shops and then that would help pay the capital on the new one.
Okay. All right. Do we have highway tracking meeting today?
I guess I had it. I did have it on my schedule.
Okay. Very good.
Running out of hours.
Yeah, I thought we changed that.
I still had it on my schedule too.
I have it on mine too.
But you got other meetings. I think you two both have other meetings, don't you?
Unless we did it afternoon.
Yeah, I'm pretty flexible. We can talk after the meeting and get something scheduled.
Do you have agenda items that need to be covered?
Yeah.
No, that's okay. That's right.
I just got one item that I left in my folder.
No, that's, we'll just schedule the meeting then. We'll just set it up for, I mean, are you available this afternoon then, or?
Early afternoon, yes.
Whatever.
So you need an approval for this second piece?
Yeah, item number two is, it's the TAP project on Barnesville. It's the PATH project. They did have their bid opening last week. The city contingently approved the bids based on the county also approving them. The engineer's estimate was, I think it was 126.
46.
Yeah. It's so confusing how
146,873 is what's on our.
Yeah, I think that there was some revisions made to that, and the actual engineer's estimate was 173,417. The low bidder was Haug Incorporated from Detroit Lakes, and that just phenomenal bids. It came in at $108,599.34, so well underneath the grant amount, and it should be. They did contingently approve the bids, I guess.
I'll make a motion to approve the TAP project.
Second.
Any further discussion on that? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passed.
The addition item that I had, like I said, it would be it's a non-motorized recreational trail limited use permit from MnDOT, and it's basically being that the part of the trail's in the MnDOT right of way. There's a agreement and there's a resolution. Colleen, does Vicki have both those put together? I think I sent her the resolution, a copy of it.
Yeah.
And is it in the packet?
Yeah, it's in the packet.
Yeah. I guess maybe one thing that I didn't do that we should contingently approve would maybe having Jenny take a look at it and make sure from a legal standpoint that there's no things there. But I'll give her a copy of it. And then other than that, I think I would recommend we go ahead and approve the limited use agreement. Like I said, it's for putting a trail within MnDOT right away. It's kind of a standard agreement that they put together.
I'll make a motion to approve that as well, Mr. Chair.
Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passed.
Mr. Chair, that was with the consent.
Yes, pending legal review.
Very good.
Thank you.
You want a break? Okay, we'll take a short break. Okay, we'll call the meeting back to order and we'll start out with Mark Sloan on presentation from Information Services for the 2017 budget.
Thank you. I'm glad to be here.
We can talk about the budget some, but I also wanted to talk first a little bit about what we do, information services. Sometimes there's a little confusion. We have two separate departments, information services and technology services. Technology services is our sister department. They're the folks that handle all the infrastructure, basically the computers and the networks and the, all the hardware it takes for everything to work. Our department, information services, our job is to provide the information that people need to do their jobs. That's done through one of our big programs is our geographic information system and our online and our mapping systems and all those types of things. We also provide a lot of other functionality, data systems that people use. One of our employees is the guy that's recording this meeting right now. That's part of what we do. We do all the multimedia stuff, which would include meetings like this. We do posters and a lot of those type of activities. Just on a side note, one of the activities we're in charge of is I'm actually the E911 addressing authority for the Clay County. In 2015, we issued 583 new addresses, and 172 so far this year. A big project that's coming up that you may not hear about directly, but is going to affect us all in some way, is something called NG911. We use Enhanced 911 now, which is when you call 911, it tells you where the call is coming from. And that's based on phone records. As time has changed, more and more calls are coming in through cell phones, so the systems are adapting over time. NG911, or Next Generation 911, actually places the call on a map when it comes in, and then that information is displayed to the dispatcher. So instead of it coming in through the phone system like it did with our old landlines, now since 80% of 911 calls are cellular calls, it actually puts them on the map, then it displays all the responders and all that kind of stuff.
Who puts it on the map? The
phone system does.
The phone system itself does.
Yep. As it comes through, the phone call comes into the dispatch center. Their software there figures out exactly where that call is. It puts it on a map, and then the map displays the emergency responders that they should be sending out and where it is.
So, as long as you have an old phone, that wouldn't work, though, would it? Or is it just the new phones that do it? Or
yeah, and I think all the phones that since like early this century are probably going to work for that. And even if they can't, they'll triangulate off the towers, so they still should find a location of where you're approximately. The catch to all that is to make that function is we have to provide the data it takes to drive that, the map displays and the information. And we've been working with our counterparts around here to provide that. Each state is responsible for coming up with how they do that. Catch for us is we have two states at our regional dispatch center. So Minnesota is coming up with standards that says your maps should look like this, and North Dakota is doing the same thing, and of course they don't match. Mm-hmm. So we work with our friends across the river, and we're going to make all of our data comply to that standard, and that's going to be happening over the next several months. That's just, you know, one of those things that happens. We do a lot of those types of activities that people may not always see. We make maps, I mentioned before, paper maps even. One of the things I want to talk about really briefly is we're doing a new property search tool on our website. It'll hopefully come out in next month, I'm hoping. It'll make it a lot more efficient on cell phones, mobile screens. Mm-hmm. You know, what we're really trying now to do is make sure all the products we're delivering online are mobile friendly. That's a big piece of what
How
we do.
How hard is that to make that compatible?
It's quite hard. Yeah, we're basically rewriting everything to make sure.
So you basically have to have one standard for a desktop and one standard for a mobile?
Not quite. What we are doing now is we're using something called adaptive technology. So it actually, if you pull it onto a bigger screen, it'll look different. Okay. But we have to basically rewrite what we had before. So that's we're always trying to constantly look at how do we best deliver the product to our consumers. Information services, one thing that makes our department a little more unique is we provide information to both our internal users, which is all the county staff, mm-hmm. as well as external users, which is the citizens and the organizations that function inside our county. So we're always trying to look at how do we best get the information they need to do what they want. Open Data Portal is a new piece that actually is up and running now, which provides access to our information in a more effective way. So we're always trying to figure out how to do those types of things so that we're providing the best product we can. So when I put together my budget for this year, it's like it always has been in the 19 years I've been here. We always hear the same thing, which is, you know, money's tight, don't spend any extra. So we try not to. One thing I have a good and a bad, I guess, is we have two of our biggest contracts, which are for software, which include our GIS software, which is from a firm called ESRI. We have an enterprise license agreement with them that is a three-year contract. We also have a three-year contract with Civic Plus, which provides our website software. Those are both large ticket items, and they're three-year contracts that both expire at the end of this year. So we'll be negotiating new contracts with both those firms in early 2017. My guess is that our costs are going to go up. I'm pretty positive that they're not going to stay totally flat. So if you look at my budget, the only item we're increasing next year is our software money. We increased it by $10,000. Fortunately, I guess it depends on how you look at it, we had a staff replacement take place right now. We're replacing a longtime staff person with a new person, which will move us back on the grid substantially, which at the end of the day, I end up with a total budget change of minus $843 from last year to this year. That's what I'm asking for. So I'm asking for a slight decrease, but an increase in one line item. Mm-hmm. So it was a good timing, I guess.
Normally we approve decreases.
Yeah, that's good. But so that's, you know, as we look at this, we try to look at our staffing costs, and those are pretty fixed. But we look at where else we're expending money. We try to make sure that we're doing it as cost effectively as we possibly can. And that's why we look at these multi-year contracts. Almost every time we sign a 2 or 3 year contract, especially for something like software, we can usually get a substantially better deal than if we buy it at a shorter term. So that's why we do that.
So your individual budgets for these different departments, the salaries and stuff is not figured in their individual budgets. That's a different...
No, that's in here.
It is in there, too?
Yep.
The salary is, Mr. Chair, but the increase for 2017 is not.
Okay, see, that's what I'm talking about.
I thought that's what you were referring to.
No. Yeah.
Well, yep. But the COLA you put as a line item.
We put that as a line item.
Right. Mm-hmm. But okay. The actual salaries for our individuals is here. That's right. What allows us, so if we have a staff change, like we have somebody go from step 12 to now we'll have a new hire at step 1 or 2.
Well, that's what threw me off there when you were talking about the salary, that you're going to save the salary. And then we're going to 3.25 in.
No, that helps my bottom line.
Okay.
So that we're able to better leverage where those dollars come from and where they go. Any questions?
Thank you, Mark.
Thank you for looking for decreases. Always keep looking.
Yeah. Well, everything we do, we try to figure out how's the best way to do it. And that's why we're always talking about how do we deliver this data? How do we, you know, how do we do it cost effectively?
Right.
So that's all. That's the whole of ours.
And I'm sure Kevin will have the same type of information for us there. We'll go with the soil and water. Carol, you coming up here too, or? Right now we're going to have the Soil and Water Conservation District budget review.
I hope you all have got a copy of it before you do.
Yeah.
I just have some handy. You don't need to look at it now. It's just some information. Kind of some of the services that are provided by us in the county. But with our budget request this year, unlike Mark, I guess we are asking for a 3.2% increase, and working with Darren's office at the HR department here, some of the cost of living adjustments is what we probably our largest increases with staff this year. The state of Minnesota has offered some grant funds to us to try to increase our district capacity, seeing the need with this buffer initiative. I know you've heard a little bit about it.
I've heard a lot about it.
Yeah, I know it. You're going to be hearing a lot more about it because there's a lot of things that are coming down here. As of July 1st, a new map is out, and I've asked Mark to put one together for us. So he's got a few already. I have a Farm Bureau meeting on Thursday out at a farm north of Glendon, and I know it's going to be a lot of questions as far as how is this going to be handled, how is the district going to be working with the landowners in Clay County, because basically the legislators doled that role out to us to work with the landowners. to get 50 feet of grass planted along buffer strips, basically they're called, along streams, rivers, and wetlands in the county. And then also along the drainage ditches in the county need to have a buffer strip of 16 and a half foot wide. There are some decisions that the county board will have to be making before next March, because enforcement part, I know we've talked a little bit about that in the past, enforcement of these streams, rivers, and wetlands can fall into the lap of the county if they choose to be the enforcement part of that. Otherwise, you're looking at it going into the hands of the state agency, the Board of Water and Soil Resources. You know, we're hoping that the county board will take that role on, primarily because I think there's a lot to be said to have it done locally, and I know the landowners I've talked to are hoping that it does not go into the state of Minnesota's hands. So hopefully, like I said, we'll know more. The legislators, the tax bill that was in the budget, that hopefully a special session will get called, that maybe there will be some funding to assist the county board to fund some enforcement action. But as of right now, we're waiting to see a special session.
When you look at enforcement action, would you be doing that, or are you talking to the county?
That would be the county's responsibility. So whether you would have to have, you know, our part in this program is to work with the landowners to let them know what law is in place, what's required of them as far as, you know, if they have a stretch of stream or river that is in need of this buffer, that, anyway, as you get closer to the Buffalo River, the main branch of the Red River, you know, they already have plenty of trees, grass in those areas. It's those areas where farmers are probably encroaching, getting close to some of these streams and rivers. And the DNR was given the responsibility of putting together a new public waters map showing these areas that need to have this buffer strip on them. And that map is now available. And like I say, Mark has been gracious enough to, I asked him yesterday, he's going to have it ready for us today. So like I say,
he's got it back there.
I appreciate Mark. A lot of times we ask of him maybe things that, well, definitely things that I can't do computer-wise, but he's been very good to help with. But like I say, primarily we're seeing a big promotion with this buffer initiative. The state of Minnesota has some funds to assist. Hey, Paul. The state of Minnesota has some funds to assist us, so we are looking at hiring a new staff person. We have a part-time person that we've hired for 90 days to see how things are going. But I think all of us feel the need for increasing our district capacity by, you know, we need another person there to do some of this extra work. And for sure, the next couple of years is going to be a lot of on-the-ground meeting with landowners, whether it be meetings or on the job. You know, if they want some assistance as far as where this buffer strip has got to be, that's our role, is what the legislators have rolled out to us. So we'll be working with those folks a lot. I guess some of the decrease in our budget this year is our office space. And you know, we worked with you folks last year. We were very uncertain as far as where we were going to be going. Our USDA partners, we're going to be eliminating some of our space that they were allowing us to be in. We came to you folks to see what could be done, if we something we could work with you folks on. And you know, we had everything in line pretty much to go to the joint facility out there with the highway department. And unbeknownst to us, the USDA came back and did a two-year extension with their USDA partners with our landlord. So we're kind of on hold right now. Our space is definitely getting to be tighter with a new employee coming on. I think we're going to be cramped as it is, but there's still some potential to expand the building that we're in. So those are things that we're looking at also. I guess additional items that we see as far as coming down the road that we would like to expand on are, you know, the County Ag Inspector program is something that was transferred the responsibility to us here back in, I think it was 2012 already. And we see that program as we would like to increase, you know, some more of our spraying efforts out there. There's getting to be some weeds in the county that I had never heard of before that are getting, I think I'm going to blame it on Becker County, because I think they're coming this way, because they seem to be moving from east to west. But there are some things that, you know, some wild parsnip, some common tansy, there's spotted knapweed, stuff that I'd never heard of before, in conjunction with the leafy spurge, which doesn't seem to go away. So that effort has gotten to be where we see a need potentially for some, you know, some additional help out there for our roads that which need we need some extra attention.
When we spray every year, Do we just spray for Levy Spirit, or do we spray for all kinds of, because I got a call yesterday on.
You do? Well, we hear about it, I just wouldn't say daily, but it's quite frequently, you know, and we never hear that we're doing a good job, guys, you know.
That wasn't it, though.
And it usually prompts us to get out there, take a look at it with the landlord, or the landowner. You know, our role is county roads, county property, basically. A lot of the land that is problem areas are on township roads. You know, their township have some responsibility as well. A lot of the townships like to put the blame or call us into it to come work with it if you have a private landowner out there. And well, you know, we're happy to come out there and deal with the landowners, but actually the responsibility by state law, each township board member is a ag inspector by law, unless they designate somebody to be that go-to person on their board. So we're happy to go out there and work with the guys, but a lot of times we would just as soon have, I guess when Carol was on the town board in Cromwell, we would work with Carol to go out there with her and meet with the landowner, because there's about a dozen weeds that are listed by the state as being noxious that need to be controlled. It's a job we'll have for the rest of our lives, because the weeds they just don't go away. But leafy spurge definitely is one that everybody seems to have an idea of what it looks like. And yeah, that isn't the only one we're trying to control. So we, a couple years ago, took the initiative through our board to go and purchase a backpack sprayer and some spray that we thought if we could help out some of the townships when we're out and about, if we can help out townships on small patches, let's take care of those darn things. We do that on the county roads as well. We do hire a vendor to spray most of the county roads that we set a meeting up with Dave Overbow in the spring, myself, two of our other employees in the office, and then also the vendor that we hire to kind of formulate a game plan to spray for that year. Right now, you guys have been gracious enough to increase our spraying allotment each year. We're up to $20,000 a year, but you know, that covers about maybe a third of the county. So we're hoping to, you know, expand on that. We went and purchased a unit that sits on the back of an all-terrain vehicle that we just purchased with hopes that we can do a little bit more coverage for those entities. Kind of leads into another portion of the program here, and I did hand out, there is a new initiative this year, and I just found out about this last Thursday, that the state of Minnesota has a set of plans in place that they have got each county on a different tier based on what the county allotment that you folks provided to us back in 2014. It's in this other handout that I have here. There is based on what your allotment was to us in 2014, the state is willing to, whatever our increase that we're requesting from you or that you're willing to increase for us this year, we're asking for about a $6,800 increase. If we would go up to $18,000, if you folks would be interested in going to an $18,000 increase, the state would come back in and match that at $18,000. So a one-to-one match. We talked a little bit briefly about this before coming over here this morning, that our county ag inspector program is something we would like to improve on. If that would be something that you folks would be willing to go, you know, take that roughly $12,000 over our $7,000 increase that we're doing, if you would be willing to go up to match that to an $18,000 level, the state would come back in and match your additional $18,000. We would be willing to put those funds towards our ag inspector program to do more out there on the county property, county roads, and that type of thing. So like I said, this just came to me last Thursday. So our budget request went into you, you know, the end of June, asking for a 3.2% increase, which was equated to about $6,800. Like I say, if you would be willing to go up to an $18,000 level, the state would match that $18,000 level. So it just, like I say, I apologize for just getting to you late. It just came to my attention last Thursday, so it's just.
And there has to be the $18,000 level. There's not another tier.
That's the max we can go.
Our tier, we're in tier three based on that. There's three different tiers there, Jenny.
Yep.
The county, if you, and like I said, it's entirely up to you, if you would fund us at our request of $6,800, the state will also match that at $6,800. Okay. It's just that we could max out what they'd be willing to do if you went to 18, right.
May.
Please do. Okay.
So the other part is with Bowser on this, the whole part of this matching came to help counties throughout the state or districts throughout the state be able to give them more funds for to increase their operation. They're starting with the counties with the lowest allocations first, and they're getting a match of 1 to 1.25. We're statewide, we're in the upper third, and with that, we get a 1-to-1. The money that's out there, there will be a cap to it, but it's gonna start at the bottom first,
okay.
And then whatever's money left, it reaches to the bigger ones at the end. So the 18,000 may or may not happen,
right.
You know, if they run out of the money, but I think the way it typically works, those smaller ones may not have the money to do
the most
work anyway, so we'll end up with it. I'm going to throw one other comment out, and this is up to you. In that idea of bringing it toward working with the ag, with the ag inspector and the way the spraying of the weeds. If you want to talk to Dave, maybe look at your budget. You see what I mean? That Dave's using already, for the county ditches. And if you see that a way to work with it, yeah. I don't know that we'd want to do it all of it, but I mean, possibly there would be a little bit, so we help each other.
Mm-hmm. I haven't had a chance to read this yet, but is this a one-year program, or is this a...
It's a one-time, and if this program continues, again, right now legislators through the Clean Water Fund gave us this $22 million to increase operations throughout the state. Next legislative session, we're going to be going back to the general fund. So we don't know,
that 18,000 would disappear then.
Right, exactly. We've just been fortunate for this biennium in the help to the districts throughout the state. We're hoping they'll hold the same the same levels, as they see the work being done with the buffers and all that, but there's no guarantee. It's legislative, so.
And districts have no taxing authority, so this is one way to try to increase our, getting more work done that's being asked for of us to do.
And a lot of the catalysts off this originally is they had been, legislators had been showing over a number of years that we weren't having enough money to sustain our operations. The other part was the fact it just gave that possibility of doing it without needing more taxation. So it just came through the state.
We've also, on another twist, I guess, we've also started an urban conservation program, something that we've always been able to work with entities within, towns, people, and other cities, but we just haven't had really the time or the expertise to venture into that realm. We hired a new person, our district coordinator, started here a little over a year ago, and she has been put into this role of working with urban conservation, basically working with like the river keepers over in Fargo. So we've had some joint workshops with landowners Clay County folks have been going to some of their workshops that the river keepers have had and wondering why doesn't Clay County have such a program, like bringing rain barrels together. Some of these compost tumblers. We're working with a couple of schools in Moorhead to do some rain gardens for them. And Mandy, our new person that our district cooperator, kind of took that role under her wing and is working with river keepers in that capacity. So we're hoping to get the word out that conservation isn't just for the rural folks, primarily who we've worked with was landowners throughout the county, but also for people in town here too. That there's a need for the composting, the rain barrels, all this stuff is working with conservation that seems to fall into our lap. So
I do want to commend your staff on that, because it has been a nice branching out of the agency, because you are working with a different maybe demographic of people, but also because of the urban piece, you've also been able to work with other agencies that are also within the same realm. And so I think it's been a good thing for Soil and Water to branch out to different, because taxpayers do fund your program, and so to be able to branch out to more taxpayers, it's been a really positive thing.
I guess people always have known us. I think a lot of towns folks, you know we have tree program, that type of thing, but a lot of the other things, I mean, we can do erosion control if they happen to be along rivers and that type of thing in town, but just the idea of having some pollinator habitats, we're working with a few people in town with want to have small areas where the big, the word with the honeybees and stuff like that we're having so much trouble with in the world. There are a lot of people that in town would like to have some little pollinator habitat, little flower garden, those type of things. So we've got a person in the office that will work with them. And this, like Jenny says, this just kind of brings a different clientele into our office that these things are available through us. So it's been, you'll see some of the stuff. We're at the fair Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, and we're going to have some of these pieces there, the rain barrels and these compost tumblers on display there. So, and then information on this buffer initiative too, which I know is a hot topic with everybody in the counties. Okay. One other item, I guess there's in your packet that there's a government water roundtable meeting coming up on August 4th in Detroit Lakes. It'll be including watershed districts, SWCDs, and also AMC there. A lot of it will be focusing on this buffer initiative. So if you can attend, in Detroit Lakes is the meeting that's scheduled. And Brian probably has gotten wind of some of this stuff, maybe it has passed to you already, but just a reminder, this would be to save the date, it would be a good session, hopefully, that you could attend, I guess. So
that's our one chance for if we have all three entities coming together at the same time, along with Bowser and DNR. So one can kind of really get down to the nitty gritty on the mapping along with the implementation that we're in charge of.
Do you know where that meeting's held? It's not on this.
I've got Detroit Lakes, and that is.
Oh, here it is.
Is it a more tech or Detroit Lakes Tech?
No. Okay.
I don't see it, Jenny.
All right, I can call. Thank you.
Brian, did you receive an email?
You know, I don't, Mr. Chair, I don't recall receiving that email.
If you did, I did get one from AMC. I can forward it to you.
Oh, okay, would you? That'd be great. Thank you.
Okay.
Is there anything else out there that you would like to have us do? Like I said, we're always open to taking on new things, and I see you guys haven't been shy in the past of,
Well, we're afraid if we ask you to do some more, you're going to have to increase your budget again then.
Well, that's always a threat, I guess. But like I say, you guys have brought to us some things that seem to fit our office fairly well. You know, some of the water plannings, some of the county field out officer program, the weed inspector program. Hopefully, if you hear stuff out there that you'll negatively, you let us know, because definitely we want to follow up and how can we make things better. But also, like I say, we're open to, if there's something else you see that you would be a better fit in our office, or something new coming down the road. Like I say, this buffer initiative is going to really inundate us here, I think, in the next year or two, because the seeding date that landowners have to have these buffers planted by is November 1 of 2017. So there's not a whole lot of this year growing season, you're not going to plant much this time of the year. There are some allowances if you do native plantings after November 1st of a dormant seeding. But other than that, you've got basically next year's growing season to get things planted. There's a lot to be done in a short time.
Kevin, what are you hearing in regards to seed shortages?
Haven't heard anything about that yet. I think a lot of it is going to be, there was a CRP program last year that very few people got accepted into it, and typically on CRP plantings, native grasses is preferred. A lot of people, like I mentioned a little earlier, the pollinator habitat, a lot of people that were willing to plant a little bit of a certain small acreage of pollinator habitat to attract bees, those got higher points, so they probably got accepted into the program. But with this buffer initiative, landowners can take advantage of a CRP program, let the government pay for part of your practice out there. Mm-hmm. But if landowners don't want to fool with the government, which a lot of them don't, they are still on the hook to plant some type of perennial vegetation along our streams and rivers and wetlands. So they're still going to have to do something out there, and that's where our role comes into this, that if they are don't want to who do with the work with the government programs that are available, then we need to come up with something that to plant some type of perennial vegetation. And the landowners, if they've got livestock, they can hay those areas so they can take a crop off mm-hmm. it yet. They can also graze it if they have livestock. You know, and maybe that isn't such a very feasible option because you start having a 50-foot buffer along a stream or river, you're going to have it fenced. Mm-hmm. And you got to have some water facility, you know, some type of water for the livestock. So that one I don't see as being a real popular one. But, you know, you don't have to plant native grasses. There are a lot of tame grasses, you know, brome grass. You can plant alfalfa if you want to take a crop off there. So there's lots of different options for landowners that, you know, and the whole thing of being, how am I going to be compensated for taking my land out of production? You know, and I understand completely. I grew up on, well, we all grew up on farms. A lot of you probably did, too. It's the landowner's livelihood is the land that they're taking out of production. So I talked to Nancy Gunderson yesterday just to see, is there anything that she's hearing for any tax reduction in, you know, taking these areas out of production for these landowners? And she said that she hasn't heard much about it. Hopefully there'll be some information through her tax, you know, the assessor's programs throughout the state that they're hearing. But this is a statewide program, so I'm assuming there will be some type of discussion, whether they reduce rates, I guess I don't know, but yet to be seen.
Yeah, I think soil water conservation is going to be, I mean, you've primarily been known for CRP and doing tree lines and stuff like that, and you're going to get involved in a lot of other stuff here now.
Well, like you said, that sheet I passed over the services, we have definitely taken, you know, you start talking about the things that you're involved with. Yeah, there's a lot of things we have. We're not good at any of them. We know a lot about a lot of things. We know a little about a lot of things, but not a lot about most of them. So we've got our hands in definitely a lot of different things that are you know, working with the landowners. That's where we come into play. Typically, the landowners come to us voluntarily. They want something that we have a service to provide to them. This buffer initiative is changing that, forcing us to go out to deal with them because it's by law something has to be done. So we'll see how white our hat stays. We'll see.
Well, that's an important issue, that buffer thing, where if they're going to take that out of taxes, you know, 50 feet of all our areas, our ditches, our waterways and stuff like that, that could take a lot of land out of the taxing district.
If you had both sides of a stream and it was a mile long, you'd be taking 12 acres out of production at 50 feet. So
my understanding, there hasn't been anything said yet that's going to happen, but it is being discussed.
Well, I would think that a farmer would be concerned about having 12 acres taken out of his production area. Yeah. Carol, you had something?
Then they're also discussing alternative plans, but rather than just planting the grass, there could be some alternative practices done. That hasn't been
The details decided. Haven't been worked out. I mean, potentially, if you had maybe you had an area where a gully was going into your stream or river, if you had those type of things, potentially you could go in and to reduce that sediment getting into the stream or river, then you could put a drop pipe in there or something that would force the water to go through a culvert or that type of thing, rather than just letting it run, you know, a gully through your field. So there are some options available potentially for landowners to offset a grass buffer by putting in this, you know, a pipe or some type of a structure. We were at a meeting last week in Detroit Lakes that still hasn't been worked out yet. And you know, they're basically saying to us, if the landowners take the initiative to plant a buffer, you're going to be covered. So whether you need this pipe or not, if you go out there and plant grass, you'll be in compliance with the state law. I mean, maybe you can add things on later, but right now, the easiest fix for anybody to do to follow the law would be to go out and you know, install a buffer along your stream, river, around the wetland. And like I say, the ditches, county ditches, the drainage ditches, they also require a rod width, a 16 and a half foot buffer on those areas too, so.
Thank you.
Any other questions, guys? And Gail.
Sorry. Thank you.
I guess we'd like to thank you also for choosing or selecting, or maybe she drew the short straw, but having Commissioner Mojo sit on our board. She's been a pleasure to work with, getting to know her a little bit. And Frank, you were...
Yeah.
You lucked out.
It's not going to help anymore. Too late now.
It's been a pleasure. I knew her grandfather and her dad, and it's fun to getting to meet this generation. So.
Sure, yeah. Very good. Thank you for that. Okay.
Thank you. Thank you, guys.
With that, Brian, your report.
Okay, Mr. Chair. Already mentioned, but we had a highway meeting with the methane gas. I need not say any more about that. Did a fair amount of budget work. Lori and I did trying to work through these things, and like I said, we apologize for not having that printout for you, but we'll promise to have that next week. Did some work in preparation for the public meeting tonight. I don't have any idea of how many there will be in attendance.
See, Brian, with that in mind, are we going to have a large size of this, the latest site map?
Yes, I do have one laying on my table, Commissioner Campbell, and we also will have it on the presentation.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I did stop out at the new landfill building. If you get a chance to stop by there,
I was out there this week too. Right there, moving along. I guess yeah. I expressed my opinion. I thought it looked small, but you said it looked big. So
oh,
I
man.
Don't
know. I thought it looked huge. Huge. 204 feet long and 90 feet wide. It's it looked big to me. But so anyway, we had management team last Thursday morning, and Darren gave a presentation on the new rules reference exempt and non-exempt employees. We have discussed that in the PIC committee, and he looked for input from the department heads, and then we'll come back to PIC committee, I think, before we bring it to the board then for some action. I personally, and I think after our discussion, we don't feel that it have a big negative impact. Even in some areas, could have a positive impact for the county. So we're not too discouraged about that. And then in a few minutes, I'm going to ask Mark to report or to bring you guys up to date on another subcommittee of the extension, the department head and commissioners meeting that we had, that retreat in April, doing some follow-up work on that, and we'd like to expand that committee. He's going to present a little bit on that. Shouldn't take very many minutes at all. Had a diversion administrative advisory meeting attended to talk about a lot of things that are going on. And of course, that's a lot of abstract things that get discussed. I had a meeting with Kirk and Brett on solid waste is working on a Facebook page for the solid waste program for the county. And so we went over some things on that and some words of caution. We'll try to follow if they decide to go ahead with it, to follow the same kind of guidelines that probably the sheriff's office and the highway use, because they are on Facebook as well, mostly for posting information. And the chair and I met yesterday to talk over some of these things in preparation. I did attend that diversion public-private partnership agreement. I thought it was quite an event. It was structured well. But it was good.
Yeah. I was very impressed with it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Good presentation.
We have that public meeting tonight. I mentioned a budget review. We spent quite a bit of time preparing it, and then yesterday we spent most of the afternoon with highway and the sheriff's office. And I'm glad to see that our bloody knuckles paid off. I think there was a good consensus building today with the board, and where we can go on a positive track with that. So had one more property meeting yesterday afternoon in amongst the budget meetings, and we're still working on the final property that we don't have a purchase agreement on, and exploring some opportunities there. We'll try to see where that can go. So that's about it, Mr. Chair. Oh, I better ask Mark, to, if you will, allow him to come up and talk about his request, or the Strive Committee, I guess. That's kind of where it's turned over to.
This isn't going to be an increase of your budget now, is it?
No.
Okay.
No, it's not.
It's pretty quick. No, Mark.
No, it's not. I actually forgot a bullet on my budget thing. The county surveyor thing that we changed last year is working really well.
Good.
So that's a really good change. What I was brought back, we had, in the spring, we did a survey of our employees to find out what some issues were. They came up with a list. At our retreat in April, we went through that big list and we hashed out and elected the top five items. Since then, we took that to the management committee. We actually did little brainstorming work sessions to go through each one of those items and find out what it would take to make it happen. Is it even doable? Those kind of questions. Now we're down to basically three of them are left that we'd like to move ahead with and looking into in more detail. But as we talked about it as a management group, we decided we needed input from somebody, some people from this board to make that happen. So what I'm asking for is to put together a little work group, which would include a handful of managers and one or two board members to go through those items and basically work out the details of what they're going to look like before we can get to an actual policy that would go to PIC and then come before it can be adopted. I think there's some work that has to be done before that. So that's what I'm here today is asking if we have anybody, if that's an okay idea, and if we have any volunteers that would be willing to help us with that.
I think it's a really good idea.
I do too.
I think I had volunteered at that meeting to serve on that committee if that's something.
Okay.
So you're still looking at additional parking, on-site daycare, the deli, and close?
Those are the five.
Closing campus and close.
Yep, and Christmas two Eve. Of them have been determined as not feasible. Well, not that's probably not the order, but daycare was, we are going to remove that from the list. The parking we decided is going to be included with some other stuff that's already happening as far as the site planning process. So it leaves the other three that we need to actually sit down and figure out how would we actually make that work and what those details would look like. And that's where we're sitting right now today.
Okay.
And Mr. Chair, if I may, the collaborative, the Clay County Collaborative has taken up the initiative of looking at the lack of daycare in the area and social services. I wasn't able to make the meeting, but social services sat in on that meeting. So that point is really kind of being explored on a bigger scale as far as the need for daycares within the Moorhead Clay County area, so we hope to have some positive things.
Oh, I was going to say why daycare was taken off, but yeah. If you're looking at it a different way, because
and it only had one priority vote on it too. So, wonder who that was.
So,
it must be all older people on that committee. There,
I think it was Frank.
No, it was me.
So, any other volunteers? Or
Mr. Chair, if nobody else wants, I'd work on two.
Well, Jenny, did you volunteer on that? Yeah.
I think you'd wanted to, right?
Is sure. What
you
just
okay.
Said?
Very good.
We'll set up some meetings and I'll send some emails.
So we'll put Jenny and
Mark.
Kevin on that committee. Very good.
Okay.
Need a motion for that, or so moved.
Okay, we got a motion to put those two on there.
With the DM.
I'll second it. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Okay. You got two new committee members.
Thank you.
Very good. Anybody else? Jenny, Lori, Colleen. Got to say something.
Welcome, Colleen.
Welcome, Colleen. Yes. We're adjourned.